How very good and pleasant it is that kindred live in unity. A family formed by faith, we gather to worship the living Lord. Lifelong followers seeking sustenance, or new disciples searching for grace. A family fashioned by faith, we gather to kneel before the giver of mercy. Children of God, come, let us worship the Lord together.
Earth will fade, but his word.
The gifts and calling of God are irrevocable. God will not reject God's people. Knowing God is merciful and abounding in steadfast love, always willing to hear our prayers and to accept our heartfelt confession, we turn to our Lord with boldness, speaking aloud the ways we fail to be people God calls us to be. Let us pray. God of all people, we come before you this day keenly aware of the ways that we fall short of your vision for us and for our life together. You tell us how good and pleasant it is when we dwell together in unity, and yet we create division and cultivate disdain. You command us to care for each other, but we send away those crying out for help. You call us and put us together in community, but we want to pick and choose those with whom we associate. Forgive us for thinking that we are self-sufficient and independent, rather than utterly dependent on you and in need of each other. Help us to see ourselves and others as the beloved reflections of the divine we are, and give us the grace to treat each other as such. And now hear us, we pray, as we bring to you our own personal and silent confessions. Amen. God does not reject God's people. God is merciful to all. Friends, believe the good news and be at peace. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. As we approach God's word once again this week, let us do so first by praying for illumination. Let's pray. Lord, the noise all around us is loud and frightening. We find ourselves anxious and distracted, worried about much that we cannot control. We long to hear you tell us not to be afraid. We ask again for the gift of your peace that passes understanding. As the word is read and proclaimed, send your Holy Spirit to help us rightly hear and respond. Amen. Our scripture lesson this morning comes from Genesis, chapter 45, verses 1 through 15. Listen. This is the story of God for the people of God. Then Joseph could no longer control himself before all those who stood by him. And he cried out, "Send everyone away from me." So no one stayed with him when Joseph made himself known to his brothers. And he wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard it and the household of Pharaoh heard it. Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. Is my father still alive?" But his brothers could not answer him, so dismayed were they at his presence. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "Come closer to me." And they came closer. He said, "I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. For God sent me before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in the land these 2 years, and there are 5 more years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest. God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to keep alive for you many survivors. So it was not you who sent me here, but God. He has made me a father to Pharaoh, and Lord of all his house, and ruler over all the land of Egypt. Hurry and go up to my father and say to him, thus says your son Joseph, God has made me Lord of all Egypt. Come down to me, do not delay. You shall settle in the land of Goshen. You shall be near me, you and your children and your children's children, as well as your flocks, your herds, and all that you have. I will provide for you there, since there are 5 more years of famine to come, so that you and your household and all that you have will not come to poverty. And now your eyes and the eyes of my brother Benjamin see that it is my own mouth that speaks to you. You must tell my father how greatly I am honored in Egypt and all that you have seen. Hurry and bring my father down here. Then he fell upon his brother Benjamin's neck and wept, while Benjamin wept upon his neck. And he kissed all his brothers and wept upon them. And after that, his brothers talked with him. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I wonder how many of you have participated in one way or another in a family reunion. Now, growing up, for me, there was always one Sunday afternoon a year where we would make the short drive over to Graham Baptist Church. Now, that was the site of our family reunion, where we would listen to someone talk about our genealogy, how we were all related. We would sing some songs and eat. And eat and eat and eat. Oh, did I mention that we ate? Now, once we're back together, I can't wait to hear your own family reunion stories. I'm sure you've got some good ones. But for me, especially as a young person, the family reunion was always a confusing time. So many people knew who I was and knew who my sister was, but I had no clue who they were. Now, once I got to know their names and their faces over the years, I have to admit there were some folks that were a little too strange and out there for my liking. But that's family, right? There will most likely be those you like, those maybe you don't like as much, and, well, those you probably wish you could avoid. Now, if you can relate to any of that at all, well, the good news is that you're in good company. Right there with Joseph. Now, the focus of our text this morning is Joseph. And there are so many different aspects about his life that we can draw from. He's the son of Rachel and Jacob, the grandson of Rebekah and Isaac, and the great-grandson of Sarah and Abraham. Now, when you come from that family line, we should all know as readers and hearers of the word that something amazing or horrifying or confusing will certainly take place. Now, we also know that Joseph had 11 brothers and a sister. And with that many siblings, issues were bound to pop up. Ask anyone that comes from a large family. But most of all, we should know that God will be present and moving in their lives, just as God had been moving in Rachel and Jacob and Rebekah and Isaac and Sarah and Abraham. And Joseph is no exception. I mean, just think, in Hebrews 11, Joseph is listed among other heroes of faith. In Acts 7, Stephen recounts Joseph's life in a speech to religious leaders. Joseph's story obviously captured the attention of other biblical writers who followed him, and you can't blame them. Joseph's story actually spans about 10 chapters in total in Genesis, so there's a lot of material for them to choose from. Now, we first meet Joseph as a brash and self-centered younger brother of only 18 years old. He angers his brother by sharing his dreams with them, which are dreams of Joseph being lifted up or having dominion over his siblings. Now, this obviously angered his brother, so much so that they conspire to kill him. But eventually, after some convincing, they sold him into slavery instead. The brothers then go and tell their father that Joseph is dead and present to him as proof the coat of many colors that has become so synonymous with the story. Well, as it would happen, years later, Joseph catches the Pharaoh of Egypt's eye for his capacity to interpret dreams, and he quickly rises to power by being put in charge of the preparation for the upcoming 7 years of famine. I told you there was a lot going on here. The famine then leads most of Joseph's siblings to Egypt so that they could buy grain. Now, at the time, Joseph doesn't reveal himself as their brother, but instead chooses to wait until their second trip back to Egypt, which is where we pick up the story in the reading from Genesis 45. The writer of the story says in verse 3 that Jacob, quote, wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard it and the household of Pharaoh heard it. Now, if you've ever heard the expressions real men don't cry or grown men don't cry, then tell that to Joseph. Because he didn't just cry. He wept. And he wept loudly. He wept so loud that almost all of Egypt could hear him. I imagine in my mind's eye that it was a guttural cry, something raw and honest and pure, years worth of emotions built up that just overflowed in the moment. Now, was it anger? Was it frustration? Was it happiness? Was it sadness that caused him to? Well, we don't really know why. The story doesn't outright tell us. But my guess, it was probably a little bit of everything. Roger Nahm, who is the acting professor of Hebrew Bible at Candler School of Theology in Atlanta, says this about Joseph's outburst. He says the loss of control for Joseph is a bit surprising in the context of how the book of Genesis has documented the life of Joseph, who was a brash youngest child, and his lack of filter had severe consequences in his life. But through it all, he consistently displays immense control in scenes with enormous pressure, whether in prison or under sexual seduction of the wife of his master, or in the presence of Pharaoh. So the beginning of Genesis 45, in verse 1, provides a surprising shift as, quote, Joseph could no longer control himself. Professor Nahm then says, when Joseph finally loses control, it immediately leads to a display of God's greater control. When Joseph finally loses control, it immediately leads to a display of God's greater control. Along with this outpouring of emotions comes Joseph's words of God's sovereignty. Listen, God sent me before you to preserve life in verse 5. God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on earth. That's verse 7. So it was not you who sent me here, but God. He has made me a father to Pharaoh and lord of all his house and ruler over all the land of Egypt. In verse 8. Now, while we never see or hear God speak to Joseph directly throughout his entire story in Genesis, it's evident to Joseph that God has been at work in his life. And as I've said to you all before, God is already at work in our stories as well. Now, while a lot of us may not hear God speak directly to us, one way I feel that we can discern the movement of God is to pay attention to our emotions. Whether it's through our tears, our laughter, and you know what, even through our anger and through frustration, an outpouring of emotions can and should remind us of God's presence in our lives. When our inner thoughts and feelings overflow into outward expressions, our true selves are laid bare. Now, this time of uncertainty in our world has brought a whole range of emotions out of all of us. Don't suppress them. Don't hide them. Embrace them. Let them go, just like Joseph. And it doesn't mean that you've lost control. It may just mean that you're finally recognizing that you were never really in control to begin with. So look instead to the one who is and who has been all along. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Faithful to me. Friends, God's providence is evident when we take a long, loving look at our lives. The twists and turns, the disappointments and hurts, none of them were absent of God's grace and purpose. Aware that God does not reject or abandon us, but remains with us always, we respond with gratitude, giving in joy our morning's offering with confidence that God will use it to reveal God's care to others. Let us pray. Receive these gifts, gracious God, as an outward sign of our recognition of your amazing grace. There is nothing we can offer you in return for your love to us, and yet we know that you take what we give in faith. Bless and use it for the building up of your kingdom on earth until Christ comes again. Amen. As we join together in prayer for all those who dwell upon the earth, you are welcome to join in a call and response throughout the prayer. When I say, Lord, help us, you are invited to respond, we trust in you. Let us pray. God of mercy and healing. You are Lord of all, embracing the estranged, blessing the banished, reconciling the rejected. We cry out to you now, confident that your provision is abundantly more than enough to preserve the church, redeem the world, and deliver those in need. Lord, help us. We trust in you. For your people, for this house, and for the household of faith near and far, Lord, help us. We trust in you. That the church may replicate your reconciliation, model your mercy, and herald your healing for all. Lord, help us. We trust in you. For unity and harmony to flow freely among your creatures and throughout your creation. Lord, help us. We trust in you. For reconciliation and new beginnings among estranged families, races, nations, and peoples. Lord, help us. We trust in you. For healing for those who are tormented, rejected, marginalized, fearful, forgotten, cast off. Lord, help us. We trust in you. For those whose names we lift in your presence, silently or aloud. For Barbara Allen. For Barb and Ed Weil. For Betty and John Brandon. For Jeff Gilbreath and his extended family. For Virginia and Jim Wright. For Peggy McMahon. For Turner Matthews' mother. And for anyone left unspoken. Lord, help us. We trust in you. For our ancestors in the faith, now kept in your care and never forgotten by you. Lord, help us. We trust in you. We stand in your circle of favor, embraced by you, healed by you, remembered by you, secured by you, grateful for your loving care. We pray all of this to you in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Friends, as you leave this time of worship, my prayer and my hope is that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forevermore. Amen.